Welcome to the fourth lecture of the spring 2017 Baumer Lecture Series. My name is Andrew Cruz. I'm an assistant professor of architecture and chair of this year's series. Some cities capture constellations of culture and history that define an approach to architecture. Papal Rome, with its Renaissance and Baroque churches. Napoleonic Paris, with its Haussmannian housing blocks and monuments. The skyscrapers of late 19th century Chicago and post-war New York. To that list, I would add the buildings of Beirut at the close of the 20th century and the start of the 21st. Tonight's speaker, Makram El Kadi, is from Beirut, and although I've just met Makram, his career as an architect and the work of his office, L.E.F.T, seems to share many things with the city and country of his birth. Lebanon is known as the Switzerland of the Middle East, a comparison that beyond skiing and banking, I don't understand. Although Switzerland straddles three languages and cultures, each remains separate and distinct. Lebanon is a polyglot mosaic of languages and cultures, Arabic, French, English, Aramaic, Kurdish, defined by a conflict-ridden history. The Swiss love Switzerland. The Lebanese, it seems, love to move. About 6 million people live in the country, while about 15 million people of Lebanese descent live around the world. Swiss is majority Christian, while Lebanon is a mix of religions, Shia and Sunni Muslim, Maronite, Greek Orthodox, Druze. Despite being, or perhaps because it's heavily militarized, Switzerland has not been affected by war, yet Lebanon, specifically Beirut, has been shaped by conflict, down to the name of its main public space, Martyr Square. The Lebanese decision theorist Nassim Nicholas Taleb, in his book Anti-Fragile, wrote about how things gain from instability, how they can thrive and grow when exposed to volatility, randomness, disorder, and stressors. This observation seems to apply to Lebanese architecture generally, and Makram specifically. The period of his birth to his graduation from the American University in Beirut with a degree in architecture roughly corresponds to the Lebanese Civil War. The AUB campus where he studied was an exception to the war's destruction, a de facto DMZ, an urban oasis that was protected not by fences and walls, but by its students, who came from all over the Middle East, representing its diversity and microcosm. On the campus, one could not attack one's enemy without attacking one's friend, indeed oneself. Following his bachelor's degree, Makram, like many Lebanese before him, left Lebanon, first for a master's of architecture degree at Parsons, then to the offices of Fukuyama Maki in Japan, followed by Stephen Hall Architects in New York. There he worked on the World Trade Center proposal and a project for the Beirut Marina. Before establishing his office, L.E.F.T, over a decade ago with his partner Ziad Jamaluddin. They currently have offices in Beirut and New York and have built a number of civic, commercial, and residential projects in both cities while teaching at architecture programs at Columbia, Yale, and other schools. The title of Makram's talk tonight, Checkpoints and Frontlines, suggests how the zones of conflict and borders that characterize Lebanon's recent history and his own might be productive for architecture. I hope the unintended prescience of Makram's visit to the school this week is not lost on you. Excuse me. The presidential decree last Friday temporarily barring entry to visitors from 7 Muslim-majority countries has given a symbolic importance to Makram's presence here tonight that we could not have anticipated when making these plans many months ago. Nevertheless, it reinforces University President Drake's message to the university community on Sunday. He wrote, "I want to affirm the university's unwavering commitment to diversity and inclusion and the value that members of the international community continue to bring to our pursuit and sharing of knowledge. For us tonight, that will be knowledge of architecture, of cities, and of the people that inhabit them." L.E.F.T's project portfolio includes the Amir Saqib Arslan Mosque in Lebanon. This was the project Rob Livesey visited last year with Makram and which began the chain of events leading to his visit here tonight. In their project description for the mosque, Makram and his partner wrote, quote, "The fight against fundamentalism is above all a cultural war of ideas, and architecture is one of its weapons." With this project, they show that architecture can be anti-fragile. It can be a way to engage, enforce, and liberate in cultural wars that know no boundaries. Please join me in welcoming Makram El Kadi.
Thank you, Andrew, and thank you, Rob, for inviting me tonight. I'm going to start by a bit introducing ourselves. As Andrew mentioned, we have a dual practice in the sense that we're working between Beirut and New York. The bulk of our work after the 2008 crises shifted towards the Middle East, so we kind of thought it was appropriate for us to open an office in Beirut. And we mostly deal with the region, although the bulk of the work is still being done in New York, it gives us a certain distance, a critical distance, for the way we think about architecture. I chose the title Checkpoints and Frontlines as a kind of a take on a book that was published probably over a decade ago by Stan Allen. My idea behind the title is to rethink architecture, not in terms of an independent, autonomous discipline of points and lines, but kind of to think about it as a politicized endeavor, where points are checkpoints and lines are front lines. How can we learn from architecture, not only as a formal exercise or an aesthetic exercise, but as an exercise in the way it can help shape our critical thinking of the society we live in. In that sense, we are historicists. We think of our architectural production as something that needs to reflect and portray to a certain degree, but also be critical of the society we built in. In that sense, we don't think of architecture as a kind of this autonomous figure, but a more of a militarized figure. How can we be engaged as architects and not just a passive receivers of ideas from clients and developers? One of the earliest projects where we tried to apply our thinking of politics at the domestic scale of architecture, this is, as a kind of a fresh out-of-school New York discipline office, we start with interior renovation. This is kind of a small renovation for a bathroom where we chose to cut out from the door the toilet paper of the door. So the bathroom is on the inside. And the idea is that if you run out of toilet paper and you're stuck inside the bathroom, somebody can change the toilet paper without necessarily bothering you. So this is kind of politics at the domestic scale. It goes to tell you that we know our shit when we talk about architecture. So this is something very interesting. I mean, this is later on, we started reading Zizek, for example. He talks about the different types of water closets between, for example, a country like France, where when you do number two, the poop goes directly into the drainage system without you looking at the actual, from an aesthetic perspective, versus Germany, where it sits in the water and you kind of figure out what if you have any problems, physical problems, stuff like that. So it's very interesting the way every single item that you design potentially has a significance politically. One of the first projects that we did, we were invited by a cultural magazine from Montreal, Canada, to do a contribution to the magazine for the occasion of the Francophonie summit that was to be held in Beirut. So it was interesting for us to use a medium that we could insert inside of the magazine, and we thought of the postcards that have been so far produced of Beirut and Lebanon in general. The idea that Andrew talked about, that we are very critical of, the idea of Beirut being the Paris of the Middle East or Lebanon being the Switzerland of the Middle East, we were always thinking how can we be not compared to any other country, but I mean there must be some sort of a specificity or idiosyncrasy to the country itself that we, as architects, we wanted to kind of portray. And we didn't want to recreate postcards after 30 or 50, 20 years of war that would recreate stylized images of the city, but we wanted to tackle through postcards the problems or the social taboos to a certain degree that existed and or were created because of the war or were present before the war and kind of helped to start the war in a way. There were causes behind the war. So this is kind of the image that we were critical of. So we started, the series of postcards spanned from environmental issues that were at that time present, but nobody was talking about issues of focusing on the city center versus neglecting the periphery. The reconstruction of Beirut focused all the money on the city center rather than helping creating a flat development for all the neighborhoods or the regions of Lebanon. The other aspect was from a key chain. How can we depict the social constraints or the social mood that was happening in Lebanon? I mean, in the sense that through your key chain, you can know that there's no public transportation. Each one has his own car, even if you have dense condition in the city. You don't have public transportation. So your father has a car, your mother has a car, you have a car, your siblings has a car. Also, the multitude of residences that is typical of a Lebanese family household. You have a house in the mountain, you have a house in the city, you have a house on the beach also. So it's kind of from a very simple element trying to recreate a holistic view of the society. Another thing that we placed a fake ad in one of the newspapers calling for smaller housing units in the city. At that time, most of the development was happening for involving big apartment units, catering to mostly Arab Gulf visitors to Lebanon, and there was no need or no requirement for to cater for Lebanese local communities. So that was kind of an ad that ran for about a month in one of the newspapers. What it means to drive Lebanese, kind of the way the Lebanese, they don't necessarily follow any logic in terms of following a rule of law, as depicted in driving, for example. What it means to be Lebanese, this is something very interesting also, this multiplicity of identities that prohibits us from defining or pigeonholing what a Lebanese is specifically. And this is a kind of a richness that we think is always interesting. This is something also that, I mean, that was done probably in 2006, so that, 10 years ago. The idea of refugees that is now becoming also another issue. The idea that Andrew also talked about, the idea of Lebanese living outside of Lebanon, becoming a transit hub for refugees coming in, or even human trafficking at that time that was happening. And Lebanese exiting, so that was kind of one of the postcards that depicted that. The idea that is now also resurfacing in Lebanon, we have like geographically the allocation of land given to Lebanese pot was way more than the land of cedars, which was on the Lebanese flag. The idea of civil marriage, as you might know, in Lebanon, it's forbidden for you to marry civil marriage. So if you're a Christian, you can only marry a Christian. If you're a Muslim, you can only marry a Muslim. So people tend to go to Cyprus, get married in civil marriage. That gets accepted at the end in Lebanon. So we created kind of a fake also civil marriage certificate. A gay pride, also gays are starting to get their rights in Lebanon. So a series of issues, most important also was something that also resurfaced probably a year ago with the garbage crisis that happened all over Lebanon. This is a postcard that depicts both the quarries that are happening in the mountains, that are flattening the mountains, and the garbage that was being dumped in the sea that was raising kind of mountains in the sea directly. So kind of this dual relationship between quarries and garbage. So we took kind of later on, after 5-6 years from doing this project, we were commissioned by Solidaire, which is the development company in charge of the reconstruction of downtown Beirut, to do our first cultural project, and the first cultural project in the city, a temporary structure that would be placed in the new reclaimed area of downtown Beirut. So this is the whole, this is downtown Beirut, and this is, there's a green line here that divided the predominantly Muslim West Beirut from the predominantly Christian West Beirut. The only thing during the war between both factions, the only thing that they could agree on was where to dump their common garbage. So they ended up dumping their garbage in downtown Beirut, which was the no man's land. And eventually, Solidaire was able to engineer a viable area to build on it, above the dump. So that was interesting for us in terms of the history of the site itself, and in terms of being building in a place that we don't know how it will look like eventually. It was an existing structure that we were asked to clad. And our idea was, we're working within an environment that is not clear. It's kind of in limbo. So it's not clear from the outside and from the inside, given that it's a temporary, it's a structure for temporary exhibitions. So it's kind of, the skin is caught in between this undefined exterior and undefined interior. So for us, it was interesting to think of a reflective material that would not only show its context, but also kind of the changing weather around it. And the idea is, once you have this structure clad in a mirror material, then as the city changes each time you look at the structure or you take a photo of the structure, it will be an index of the growth of the city that is happening around it. We placed the structure to further kind of accentuate this immaterial finish on the facade. We placed the structure in a pond of water, in a, so kind of a very thin reflective pond of water. And we placed a garden with a cafe here for exhibitions overflow from inside of the exhibition space towards the outside, and an art park towards the south of the project. This is a quick model that we did of the project. The plan is kind of a simple white box with movable partitions on the inside. And that was kind of the finished project. It was supposed to last for 4 years. I think it spanned for 6 years. Unfortunately, nothing got built within these 6 years that it was present because of the crisis in Syria and whatnot. So the thing is, I mean, it's now dismantled and they're gonna probably relocate it somewhere else. So it still has a life, but it's now in a storage place somewhere. This is the idea of this reflectiveness of the city that is kind of distorted in the view of the in the material, which is anodized mirror aluminum. So these are photos of the project. From the inside, it's kind of a simple white tube with really important Arab, focusing on more on Arab artists and Lebanese artists specifically. We were honored recently, it was chosen by the Middle East Institute at Columbia University to be the front page image on their website. Last year, we sent a group of students from Columbia to investigate one of the more important streets of downtown Beirut, which is the Hamra Street. The importance of Hamra Street, which was kind of running east-west, and it had buildings that would front north and south, it was one of the earlier examples of modern architecture in Lebanon. So that's why it was very interesting for us to investigate. And what we were specifically interested in, and this is something that can be applied everywhere, I think, it's not necessarily a Lebanese problem, but the interesting thing about now the current development that is happening with buildings in Lebanon is that the relationship between architecture and urbanism is a kind of a straight shot relationship. You don't have any interaction at the ground floor level between what is an architectural product and what is an urban condition of a street level. What Hamra showed, what the architects, early modernist architects in Beirut did at Hamra, they elevated the building so that the relationship between the ground floor and the architecture, between the urbanism and the architecture, became a three-dimensional relationship. So you had cinemas going down to the basements, and you had upper retail level, creating a very dynamic ground floor articulation. Besides the fact that it was one of the earlier places to investigate curtain wall conditions on the north. These are the different movie theater that happened there. On the south facade, you see a totally different articulation of the buildings. So it's kind of this interesting double take on architecture. This is the series of theaters that existed there. This is a building by Alvar Aalto. I think Rob may have visited also. So you see the north facade is doing something. The south facade you see here, the horizontal louvers are doing something else. So we kind of took these conditions of the ground floor and the basement condition and recreated it in a continuous drawing that showcased the three-dimensionality of it and the shortcuts that created. So the street is not necessarily this linear street also, but it's much more rich both in plan and in section. This is kind of a zoom in of one of the buildings that was portrayed. Take on that was later on when we started the, as we were doing the project, we were encouraging one of our potential clients to convert one of the old theaters off of Hamra Street into an art gallery, to buy it rather than kind of turning it into a mall like all the other theaters, unfortunately, in Hamra Street. So we kind of, it maintains its cultural identity. And we recreated a continuous staircase or reminiscent of the theatrical staircases of the old cinemas. We turned it into a theatrical promenade that takes the ground floor down into the basement level where the gallery is, kind of continuing, even having the possibility of sunshine coming into the basement of the project. So this was the physical model of the project, and this is the project that was completed half a year ago. Kind of this is the theatrical staircase, kind of suspended from a frame, reminiscent of an exploded art frame, if you want, a three-dimensionalized art frame, going down to the actual exhibition space. And we kept all the theater. We renovated all the theater catwalks and lighting and stuff like that. So we kind of expanded on it to create this white box at the end. One of the earlier projects also, so I'm showing you a bunch of projects that are partly speculative, partly research oriented, and I show you how we implemented them later on in real projects. But this is one of the earlier projects also that we did. We called it the One Door House. And we were interested, this is a speculative project, so it didn't have any clients, but we were interested in kind of taking a similar approach to what Duchamp did with the urinal, taking a found object, which in this case is the revolving door, taking it and kind of trying to create a project out of it. And what's interesting with the revolving door is that it has inherently a spatiality to it. So it's not just a threshold between two conditions. It has its own space within. So what we did, we took a series of Lebanese expressions and we kind of interpreted them using the revolving door. The three expressions that we chose at the time were from inside to inside, meaning that one uses his connections to go to Ohio School of or Knowlton School of Architecture by using cronism and nepotism and like kind of inside connections. From outside to outside is the reverse. So you got based on your own credentials. From here to here is a bargaining tool that is used in commercial transaction also. So we took these conditions and we interpreted them using the revolving door. So this is kind of the outside to outside condition. This is the inside. You're always trapped in the interiority of the revolving door. And this is the here to here where you kind of build a wall around the revolving door. So you enter and exit from here to here as a folly, if you want. They could be interpreted obviously as an urban versus rural condition. So we did these series of collage to portray that. But what was kind of the jump to architecture was to take this revolving door and interpret it as a Duchampian door to the power two. If you know the Duchampian door, when you open one room, you close another room. So we took this condition and we kind of recreated a house where the front yard and the backyard are collapsed into an exterior to exterior, outside to outside condition, versus the living room and the service quarters are collapsed into an inside to inside condition. So you kind of jump from the front yard to the backyard without entering the house, and vice versa, you jump from the inside to inside without exiting the house. This is at the kind of unfolded the quarter perspective of the project. So you have the front yard here and the backyard here, which is the pool, sunken pool, and the front and the living quarters to the service quarters from the other side. On the upper floor, so this is the ground floor plan. You can take a stair up on either from either the kitchen area or the living room area, and you get to a space that is more outside in. So the ground floor was stemming from the inside, kind of centrally outwards. This one is the reverse. So this is from the outside, designed as a series of doors that you could have different partitions within it for the different rooms. The idea is that, I mean, also it caters for marital disputes. For example, you can subdivide it. You can not talk to your wife or your partner and still use the house with different conditions from within. This is an unfolded perspective of the top floor. We took a condition that was also, I think, briefly mentioned by Andrew during his introduction, and this is a geographical myth that exists in Lebanon. It's partly true, but because of the topography of the country, you have the mountains directly next to the sea. So there's a kind of a half hour delay in a certain climatic overlap where you can be skiing in the morning and you go down, or vice versa, you go down swimming in the afternoon. So this happens, but it's kind of exaggerated to a myth level by the Lebanese. So we took this condition, and this is an unfolded perspective of the house. So you park your car, which is the front yard. You take kind of a lift up to the mountain. You go back down in an inverted slide to the pool. You're experiencing the house from outside to outside without entering the house. And also you're recreating this urban myth from the mountain to the sea within the house also. So it becomes a microcosm of the general geographical condition of the country. This is a model that shows this. So you park your car here, you take this lift up, which is shown here, sunken obviously, and then you take the slide, inverted slide, back down to the pool from the mountain to the sea within the house. This is a flattened condition of the house. So how can we recreate, again, this is just an extrapolation, but how can we recreate this condition of an outside to outside that subverts the idea of a fence between neighbors? So you kind of have it, you can apply it to a level of a neighborhood to the point where it kind of creates a new sort of urbanism. We took some of these ideas and applied them to a house that we just finished in the mountains of, in a ski resort in Lebanon. It's a simple geometry for the house, two floors house, a simple rectangle on the ground floor and a twisted rectangle on the top floor. The twist and the rectangle offers us automatically, rather than having an added on structure to the house, we have an immediately covered porch, and from the other side, kind of a definition for an entry point. So rather than adding a structure on the house to dictate what these elements are, the shape or the geometry of the house gives you these elements automatically. The idea again is that to recreate kind of a continuous movement, so you kind of walk in before entering your house, you go up to the roof, and from the roof down you go to a spiral staircase that leads you down to the covered terrace below. So you're kind of always experiencing this house from outside to outside without necessarily entering the house. So you go up from the stair and you go down from the stair. And this is, I haven't unfortunately taken professional photos of it, but this is the house previously, a couple of months ago, and it's now in its condition. This is kind of the entry porch that I was talking about. You take the stair up here, you arrive here, and then you go back down to a spiral staircase from an interiorized court, back down to the covered terrace, experiencing the house from outside to outside also. So the curved place, I mean, had fun in designing the furniture even to be curved, the lighting to be curved, so everything follows the logic of the curve on the upper floors. And hopefully we'll shoot it soon. Another topic, I think this is the most important for us recently, is our research on the architecture of Islam. This started in 2011, I think. Our interest started because Islam as a religion, it's by some statistics, is the fastest growing religion in the world at a rate of 2.9% annually. And it's projected by 2025, it will be the biggest. In terms of religion, there's a paradox when it comes to the architecture of Islam, which is the mosque. Islam is bottom-heavy religion, meaning that there are way more youth to it than there are elderly people. Now, you'd expect, because of this youth population, the experimentation in the architecture of the mosque should be more. That's not the case. Recent examples of mosque architecture in Beirut, for example, try to mimic Ottoman architecture that existed centuries ago. This is a riff off of the Blue Mosque in Istanbul. This was done in downtown Beirut. This is in Istanbul, obviously. This is the new mosque that Erdogan, the Prime Minister of Turkey, is building on the Asian side of Istanbul. Also, it's going to be bigger than Sulaymaniyah Mosque in Istanbul. This is Vladimir Putin opening the mosque cathedral, what he calls the mosque cathedral, in Moscow recently, last year, I think, or 2 years ago. This is the Abu Dhabi Mosque. Again, it's kind of, this is also in an Arab country, but the idea of the opulence that doesn't never existed in Islam is something also that we are challenging. This is on the interior. It's a project that cost $1 billion to build. There was a point back in the 60s and 50s, 60s, 70s, where that was not the case, where architecture was able to portray something that is not necessarily looking backward, but is something that is progressive and forward-thinking. That was the time when Arab countries in particular, and Muslims in general, were more forward-thinking politically. So this is Abdel Nasser, who called, who was very kind of secular, and he called for pan-Arabism. And this is examples of architecture that was built at that time. So it's kind of more interesting, more modern, and more contemporary than what we have being built now. In terms of typologically, there's nothing that dictates for us as architects what a mosque should be. So the whole idea of orientation towards Mecca, for example, the earlier mosques were oriented towards Jerusalem, and there was a shift at one point with one of the mosques called Jami'atul Qiblatain, so a mosque of two Qiblas. Qibla is the wall that directs you towards Mecca. So there was a political shift also that interpreted itself architecturally. So that is not a requirement. The minaret, obviously, is a take on, I mean, it evolved from the early bell towers of the churches. The dome also is an improvement, a structural improvement that Sinan did over the churches of Istanbul. And the hypostyle wall was also a structural problem that was turned into an architectural problem. So nothing, neither in the Quran nor in the Hadith, which is the sayings of the Prophet, would tell you what a mosque should be. So unfortunately, with that in mind, we're still building as if it's a fixed and dogmatic typology. This is again the same mosque in Beirut with the churches with the church bell towers next to it. Even synagogues had bell towers. This is the dome of Hagia Sophia. So for us, it was a question. I mean, what would make a mosque be a mosque if nothing is required of it? In Arabic, there's a dual translation to the word mosque. So one of them is jami', which means a place of gathering, versus masjid, which is the place of prostration. So functionally, it depends on the scale. If it's a small mosque, it's a masjid, you can only cater towards the liturgy of the mosque. If it's a jami', which is a bigger structure, then historically, it always was a hybrid nature programmatically, meaning you had one of the earlier universities, for example, in Morocco, was in part of a mosque. So you had kind of this functionality programmatically that was embedded in the mosque that took the mosque from just being a religious structure to one that would be in conversation or in dialogue and negotiation with what is happening in the world outside. So that was an interesting thing for us to question. We were invited in 2011 in the Quadrennial of Performance and Design in Prague to present a project for that exhibition. At that time, there was, if you remember, the ban on mosques in Switzerland, the ban on minarets specifically. So you can build a mosque, but you're not allowed to build a minaret. This was one of the posters that was there, so published at that time. So our contribution was to take the well-known Aldo Rossi teatro that was done in Venice in 1962, I think, and kind of converted into a mosque. So we would take the minarets that were banned in Switzerland and convert it into a mosque that would travel the Mediterranean Sea and play on this Islamophobia that was starting to begin in Europe. So it was kind of a take on our idea of xenophobia that was happening at that time in Europe. Later on, I think 2 years ago, somebody actually built a mosque, a temporary mosque in Venice, and that was shut down after a while. This is an inverted map of the Mediterranean. So you see Italy here, you can figure it out. So it would travel from Lebanon kind of to the different cities around the Mediterranean and be kind of this place of critique from without the countries. I mean, similar to another project that we did, where it was based on you have these women on boats, I think it's called, where you have abortion boats that would dock outside of countries where abortion are illegal, and they would kind of create a communication system where people would bring people to have abortions and whatnot. So at the end, our contribution was a simple carpet, a degree zero kind of mosque that was placed at an angle with respect to the other tables that were in the exhibit. And we placed the Aldo Rossi project with the minarets. We took that further in two studios that we gave at Yale and at Columbia, asking the students to rethink what would the mosque be given all the criteria that we gave. This was in 2011. We took our first Yale students to Lebanon, to Tripoli, which is the second largest city in Beirut. And this is a project in Tripoli that is designed in the 60s by Oscar Niemeyer, never completed. So it was an interesting thing for us to ask the students to build a mosque adjacent to the Tripoli Fair, designed by Niemeyer, and taking into consideration that the foot, kind of the people coming to the mosque will be in direct negotiation also with another program that would be placed outside of the mosque, and that would reignite the unoccupied or unusable fair of Niemeyer. The outcome of that studio was a book that was published by Yale, in which we created a series of different interpretations of what a mosque could be. Some of them taking just one aspect of the kind of the mosque procession, which is water, for example, for ablution, turning it into a whole thematic experience within the mosque. Others took agriculture as kind of a component and building the mosque in between. Others took it as an opportunity to create a kind of a cultural endeavor within the mosque. So playing on the different times of the day that you pray, you'd bring different types of light and different types of artifacts within for the museum itself, for Islamic museum. And recently in 2015, we were approached by one of the politicians in Lebanon to actually design a mosque. That was very interesting for us, given the fact that the site location is of historical significance. This is in one of the oldest regions of Lebanon. This is the existing condition of the site. So it was a two-story building. This part was recently built. You can see the difference in the stone. So we kind of removed the top part that was recently added, and we kept the old historical 18th century cross-vaulted space on the inside. And we kind of created a new plaza in front of the museum also, in front of the mosque, sorry, instead of this parking that was leftover space here. So this is the existing condition. On the inside, it was a steel factory. So that was kind of an impetus for us to start thinking of a structure that would take into consideration not necessarily the fact that it was a steel shop here, but the fact that we can use the steel worker here to help us with the structure itself. So kind of creating a micro economic culture, if you want, around the mosque. So this is the interior of the space. What was interesting for us, again, based on our research on the typology, is that instead of thinking about it as the normative design for a mosque, which is to have a box topped by a dome and on one side to have a minaret, all a volumetric expression, what if we took this idea and kind of abstracted it? So the first step would be to for us to build a modern project is to kind of take an abstracted approach towards the project itself. These are earlier studies that we did, and what was interesting for us was to kind of recreate a very thin steel structure, both for the minaret and for the what used to be a volume of the mosque, and recreate kind of a three-dimensional typography that would talk, kind of become a symbol of the mosque on the outside. This is shown here. So what we did, we created a very thinly sliced, these are 4 centimeter steel members that are all oriented in the direction of Mecca. So they're not negating necessarily the direction of Mecca, although none of the volumes that are created is linear. So all of the planes in plan are curvilinear in nature, although they are formed by these stripes that are oriented in one direction. What the interesting thing about it is that on one side it becomes a solid interpretation or solid plane. When you look at it frontally, it almost disappears and becomes very ephemeral and non-existent in a way. This is the piazza that we created here, linking a 17th century existing fountain here to the actual mosque. And for us, it was important also the idea of having an exterior extension to the mosque, given at that time, I mean, the Arab Spring was happening and you had all these demonstrations starting from inside of the mosque and getting outside of the mosque and occupying the squares of the city, different cities. So this relationship between an outside and then inside was very important for us. It's mainly an intersection of 3 gates, an existing gate that we ended up keeping here to the graveyard of the father of the politician. So that was an existing kind of condition. A small gate here that took you up to the upper, a newly kind of formed piazza when we removed the top floor. And the bigger kind of gate here that would signal the entry to the mosque itself. So it's an intersection of 3 gates in a way. This is the existing fountain here. Typographically, we created a folding in the elements themselves. I'm sure, very few of you would read Arabic, but here we have the word Allah, which is God, and it's formed by a double folding of the steel plates in a way that from one side, if you read it from one side, it's a kind of it's a solid presence. So it's kind of you see the face of the letters, while if you read it on the other side, you see the void of the letter. So it's kind of a word that can be read as a negative and as a void. Relating to the idea of God as kind of a presence and absence also. So this is a detail of how the steel three-dimensional typography would exist. I mean, the other aspect of it is that usually typography has always been applied as a two-dimensional surface on museum walls or minarets or whatnot. Here, it's not only three-dimensional, but it's also structural. So, I mean, if you take it off, it helps in the bracing of the very tall minaret. So it kind of has a functional purpose besides it being symbolic. This is a rendering of the project. What we were inspired with were two Islamic anthropologists or Quranic anthropologists. One of them is Muhammad Arkoun, who died in 2010, and he wrote an amazing book called Al-Ansana wal-Islam, meaning humanism and Islam. And in it, he argues truly that the role of Islam was crucial in the European Enlightenment project. So the European modernism, in a way, or what we know as modernism, partly is not an anti, or it's not mutually exclusive to Islam, but it's kind of a continuation of Islam and other cultures, obviously. But Islam laid the ground for humanism of Islam laid the ground for the Enlightenment project in Europe. The other anthropologist is a Tunisian anthropologist by the name of Youssef Sadiq. Going back to Arkoun, the idea of humanism. That's why we, on the lower part of the mosque, we wrote the word human being. And the idea is that we're introducing, so a mosque is usually only dedicated to God. In this case, we inserted the human being in this in a new dialect that is formed between God and, I want to say man, but it's not in a gender specific way. So this idea, this Hegelian God-man relationship is kind of an interesting thing. And your relationship with God becomes something that is more personal than something that is necessarily dictated to you. Youssef Sadiq, the Tunisian anthropologist, argues that the word Iqra, which is we placed here at the end of the mosque, The word Iqra is the first word of the Quran, and it means to read. And the Quran is a word that is derivative of this word read. And his idea was, theory was that if God had wanted us to recite blindly the Quran, he would have said recite in the name of God. But he said read in the name of God, and reading here means there's a critical thinking of the text of the Quran as a text, not as a meta-narrative, if you want to talk about in a post-structuralist sense. So it's up for us to reinterpret the text as it's given to us in different ways depending on the context you're in or on the situation that you're in. So we place this at the end of the mosque as a tribute kind of to this thinker. And we created a cut in the cross vault, the existing cross vault space, which we, by the way, we plastered with the Syrian lime from Aleppo. So it was kind of very interesting for us politically to bring an association with what was happening at that time in Syria. But the idea of cutting a visual connection between the call to prayer that you would be hearing in the mosque and the visual place where the call to prayer is usually given from, which is the minaret. So it creates kind of a looping of the experience within the mosque. Corbusier, obviously, when he visited Istanbul, kind of was very impressed by this orientation towards Mecca that unifies the whole Islamic world in a way on a single idea of orientation. This is something that we've used in an exhibition later that I will show you in Oslo that we've done recently. But the idea is that this orientation dictates the whole project. So these are the arcs I was telling you about. They are all formed by these lines that go towards Mecca, but you don't perceive them as such. Obviously, the existing structure is oriented differently than Mecca, so we had to kind of create an insert within the mosque, within what became now the mosque, and we kind of created a reveal between the orientation, the carpet that we inserted, and the actual structure. This is geometrically, it's a very kind of a, not simple, but let's say a straightforward geometry. This is a model showing the added piazza that we added here. This is the tomb, the graveyard of the grandfather, the new plaza, the skylight here. This is a tree that we added here, and it's also based on our reading of one of the verses of the Quran that says that it's the verse of the fig. So we added the fig tree. And what was interesting about it, in this verse, it talks about the Arab world as kind of a general contiguity, spatial contiguity. So we thought it was relevant in this case. A series of drawings that we did that we took inspiration from early Islamic kind of depictions or cartographies where you kind of conflate the plan and the elevation together. So this is a site plan, a three-dimensional unfolding of the mosque structure. A plan elevation also showing the new formed piazza here. And these are recent photos taken of the project. It opened September 18. I'll show you a couple of photos of the opening. So you see here the newly formed piazza linking to the existing fountain. The new steps, we kind of redid the whole urban condition here. The skylight, this is kind of looking at it frontally. So you see the word Allah here, the word Insan, the newly formed plaza. The three gates, the first gate, the second gate, and the existing gate here. This is the small ablution bench, so you have a kind of a combined men and women. So we kind of try to push the envelope a little bit on these issues. This is, you can read here, barely, but you can read here the word God as a negative versus reading it here as a positive in three-dimensional bifolding of the steel fins. Again, this is the word insan here, which means the human being. And this is looking at it straight dead on. What was interesting for us is that the conditions with the light, with the sunlight, they change from time to time. So it's like continuously ever-changing structure that talks about this ephemerality and kind of intangibility of the religion itself. This is the connection between the old existing that we renovated here and the new structure. We created a series of steps that would fan out from the existing structure and to connect to the existing building. The way we've kind of dealt with the structure, I mean, we worked with an amazing civil engineer that helped us define where to put the bracing and kind of a continuity between the word insan and the word God. This is just to show you the scale of the project. This is the upper piazza here with the kind of rocks that act as small benches. This is from behind, so you see the kind of the three-dimensionality of the typography. And this is the negative word from here. On the interior, a couple of things we did. We did in addition to the skylight. So this is the cut in the skylight. This is a photo taken before we had the chance to place the carpet. So I'll show you later on photos with the carpet. So this is what's called the mihrab. The mihrab is usually an insert niche in the wall that tells you that this is the Qibla wall and this is the direction towards Mecca that you should be praying towards. And in this case, we tried to create another, I mean, similar to the older project that I showed you, but another reflective surface, but for different reasons. In this case, our interest was to, at the same time, to focus the attention of the people praying towards Mecca, obviously. But at the same time, although it's a very strong directionality, it can bring the outside in through its reflective nature. So it's kind of talks about kind of a unilateral direction, but also a multi-directional view of the world. So this is me pretending to pray for the photo. Kind of a very interesting condition of the sunlight getting inside of the mosque itself. So amazing shadows on the inside. And these are the two entries and exits, kind of, it can be used entry or exit, or you can, they can be used for men and women, it depends, I mean, kind of a flexible structure that can be used differently. You can see here between the directionality to Mecca and the existing directionality, this infill of gravel that's created kind of to lift the ground or to articulate it differently than the ground that is not related to Mecca. The carpet itself, we worked on two things with an artist from between Lebanon and London. This is the call to prayer that's translated into an imagery. So what was interesting, we approached several artists and each one was kind of giving us a different take up to a certain point where we thought to work with a sound artist and take his visual marking of the call to prayer, translate it into an image, and create it as a carpet for our space. So these are photos by Iwan Ban, who was recently in Lebanon. This is the final product. So you have this carpet that delineates the different rows on which people would be praying. And this is the actual guy. I mean, it's not fake, this one. He came in the shooting. So the skylight with amazing quality of light on the inside. These are niches where the call to prayer would be coming out from. And this is the call to prayer translated into a carpet on the floor. These are also very nice images. I mean, it has environmental also concerns. I mean, the way, because of the, when we added the skylight, we kind of increased the amount of heat that would come usually. Cross vaults usually are very amazing, I mean, environmentally. In the summer, you're cold on the inside, and in the winter, it's hot on the inside. But when we added the skylight, we kind of messed with this balance. So we created a skylight with a functionality in it also that takes the hot air and kind of channels it through these holes to kind of create the air circulation within the mosque itself. These are, again, images on the inside. This is the Iqra wall, which is the reed wall at the back of the mosque. Again, a typography that is not your typical two-dimensional typography, but it's something that kind of comes out from the wall itself. These are recent photos at night showing the project lit. The small fig tree, unfortunately, you cannot buy really big fig trees, so you have to wait 50 years for it to grow. This is from the opening, so it was a big opening. It was, I mean, politically, it was very significant in Lebanon. This is, in the same village, there's another church that was built also by the grandfather of the, our great-grandfather of the politician, that was renovated recently by him. And the village kind of became, at the time where, I mean, we're always thinking of the other religions in terms of opposition, this became a place where although it's a Druze village, Druze and Christian village, you had a mosque, you had two churches, you have this kind of idea of tolerance or multi-viewpoints for the different religions that are existing at the same time. So you had also Christian, you had the Druze religious people all at the opening. And it became an interesting, on the inside, it's a very small mosque. The space itself is 100 or 1,000 square feet. The usable space, because of the orientation to Mecca, became 700 square feet. So it's a very small mosque. So you had, the piazza in that sense also works as an amazing overflow for the people on the inside. Later on last year, we were invited to the Oslo Triennale. And we continued our research on Islam. So post the mosque itself, we kind of created a map showing around 80 or 85 important mosques that were built from the early days of the Prophet to contemporary days, contemporary times. What this showed us in terms of our research is several points. First, that the scale of the projects is increasing towards, this is the era of dictators in the Arab world. So you can kind of take this timeline and figure out the politics of the region from looking at the map. So the scale goes from super small to super big. The context goes from mosques that are entrenched in the fabric that they are built in versus mosques that are freestanding objects, talking about the monumentality of the project, talking about the people who build them rather than religion necessarily. It talks about orientation. So each one, these are from different areas of the world. So you have some that are pointing to north, some east, depending on where their location is. But that also shows us that there's a multiplicity of the architectural objects that are being built. So some of them are due north, some of them are due south. So the quality of the spaces, there's no one quality, there's no one Islam, there's several Islams, and there are several architectures of Islam. A fourth and final thing that this map shows us is the hybridity of the project. So you have mosques that were embedded in a larger university context versus becoming less and less hybrid as the political situation shifts to nowadays. This was a table that was built in the Oslo Triennale. And we're taking this also to Istanbul, where we have a show next month in Istanbul, where we took this map and we printed two sides of it. On one side, the track itself spells Bismillah, which is in the name of God in Arabic. And the idea is that in the name of God, we are showing the mosques that are being built. And on the reverse, we show in the name of God, the mosques that have been destroyed also by ISIS and by others. It's a series, among other things, showing the actual mosque that we built and kind of taking what I showed you first, Le Corbusier, as a kind of a militant figure. Now Le Corbusier's modular is a newborn, again, Muslim. So hopefully you can join us at the opening. Thank you. In the Hamra project, yeah, it was more this idea of the intersection between the ground floor and the... because the facade is a more of a technical proposition. The intersection between the architecture and urbanism is more of a social proposition, you know?
Which was activated by the
dipping in and going out. In our project, we were only dipping in because obviously he didn't own the upper floors, but in Hamra specifically, it was buildings that were designed to recreate this kind of three-dimensional ground floor condition. And this is something that we're losing, not only in Beirut, all over the world, for public and private buildings.
Okay. Thank you again.
Thank you.